we stood in line, and they told us to roll up our sleeve on our sleeve on our left arm, and they gave us the tattoo.
Suddenly, we had no names. I was A5714 from then on. I was very lucky. The first thing I'm going to say about my family, it was a great family. My father was an Orthodox Jew, and he was born in Poland. So was my mother. And as Orthodox Jews, they had lots of children because they wanted to have as many boys for the name to keep on going. My father was mostly daughters. His first wife, he had six children, and his first wife died giving birth to the last child, and so did the last child. So he was left with five children in Poland. This is my father, Moshe,
the middle of the bottom line, with his first children. Starting at the top on the left is the oldest one, Sarah. The middle one is Regine. The one on the right is Adele. At the bottom is Fanny, my half-brother, Henri.
And then he married my mother,
Baylor.
And I've heard from her saying that she had a miserable life, not with my father, before that. Her parents were not very nice to her. She had to work very hard. And so she embraced my father, married him with the five children. I don't know if she raised them or not, but they stayed in Poland until 1923. And then they decided... By the time in 1923, I'm the 14th child, he already had 12 children with both marriages. And they, except for two older half-sisters, we stayed in Poland because they were married already and they didn't want to go to France. Everybody else moved in 1923 to Paris.
This is a passport picture of my mother, 1923, from Warsaw. Going from left is my sister Ida. On top of her is my sister Hélène. Under her, Amy. And the little baby is my sister Cécile.
And there, I have one sister, Madeleine, who was a year and a half older than I am, and I, who were born.
I was born in March 1st, 1926.
My birth name was, in Yiddish, Rivenmeier Wiedermann, which is Robert Max Wiedermann. But nobody called me Max. Never, never. It was always Rivelin, Robert, and that was my name. As his last child, I was spoiled, rotten, and loved it.
My sister Madeleine, who's on the left side, was a year and a half older than I am. And then my sister Cécile was a year and a half older than
Madeleine. My father never spoke French. He understood French, but he never spoke French, always Yiddish. And if he did not want us to understand what he was saying, he would talk to my mother in Polish. My mother had to learn French because she had to go in the market, she had to go to the Western laundry, so she had to learn to speak French. Not well, but she did. And she was a fantastic human being. There was a woman in France called Madame Alphen, very, very rich, and she built an apartment house in the most beautiful section of Paris, L'Île Saint-Louis, a seven-story high apartment house for Jewish families with lots of children. You didn't have to pay a lot of rent, and I'm sure if you couldn't afford to pay rent, she didn't mind it. And it was a fantastic place. I mean, I don't know any other place. I did not live any other place. Right in the center of Paris, they have two islands, L'Île Saint-Louis, L'Île de la Cité. And it's called Rue de Deux Ponts because it's between two bridges. Because the Seine, we were on an island. And the River Seine was on one side and the other side. It was called 1012 Rue de Deux Ponts. 10 and 12. Cross the first building, you go into a hall, and then there's another building with the 12. And we were on 10. We're mostly 2 to 3, 4 apartments on each level. And it was fantastic. When we came in, we lived on the second floor, which is really the third in America, because the first floor here, we call it the rez-de-chaussée, which is not the first floor. First floor is the second floor. So we live in the third floor, but really the second floor. Am I making sense? Yes.
No.
Oh, okay. That's good. Anyway, the apartment was one of the biggest apartments they had because of the number of children my mother and father had. With a long corridor with a toilet, and just a toilet on the left side. Then you go to the long corridor, in the middle of the corridor, there was a dining room and a bedroom. Then you go, there's a huge kitchen, and then another bedroom. So there were two bedrooms, a dining room, a kitchen, and a long corridor. My father was
a remarkable man.
He was a tailor.
I was the best dressed kid in the neighborhood.
He always was a tailor, and when I was a child, we had three sewing machines in the kitchen, and he taught my two of my sisters to help him to make pants, and that's what he did. He was always at home. We went to a school. It was catered for Jewish family. Therefore, instead of going to school Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, not Thursday and Friday and Saturday, we went Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday and Sunday because our parents were religious. We did not go to school. Jewish holidays, we did not go to school. It was called Rue des Hospitalières Saint-Gervais. School for boys and a school for girls.
I graduated from my school when I was 12 years old, the first in the school.
I remember there's a teacher who became the director of the school. I had him for 2 years. When you start the school, you go to kindergarten when you're 3 years old. When you're 6 years old, you go to the sixth class. It goes from 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. When we came back from school, instead of going to our apartment, if our parents were living, working in the apartment, or if they were not home yet, we would go to a locale on the first floor.
Madame Alphen hired social workers to take care of us children from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. on the first floor. Two huge rooms where the kids will go there to do their homework and then be taken care of by these social workers.
Three wonderful women would take care of us and taught us about life and about religion.
All these young ladies, 38, 39, went to Israel.
And Madame Alphen was so great that she built a summer home in Normandy. And there, the first month, girls will go. It was a big, big, and then the second month, boys will go for a month. And it was fantastic. I always sang and danced, and since I was a child. And I think when I was 12 years old, I started professionally, though I did not miss the school, but on Thursday, I would work in the theater. I would sing and dance and loved it.
I was making money when I was 12 years old. I formed a band, an orchestra, with the kids from my apartment house. one on the left is Henri Adenauer, who unfortunately was deported and died in Auschwitz. The one next to him is Roger Elvasser, who was not deported. He was hidden in a farm, and he was saved this way. And a great, they were all great singers. The one with the mallets is Georges Goldstein, and also he was not deported. That was in 1941.
Even went to an amateur jazz contest, and we won a prize. We sang quite well.
My father would go to the synagogue Friday evening and Saturday. And Saturday he was not, Friday evening is not, he was not working. On Saturday he would walk to visit all the relatives who were married, the sisters and brother and were married. My father was great that way. All he wanted from all of us, either to get you, when you're 13, to bar mitzvah, or the girl, the bat mitzvah. And once you got that, and you know, that's your choice. You don't want to go to the synagogue. You don't have to come with me. I'll tell you why I like the bar mitzvah. I got my first ring and my first watch, and that's the only reason I was doing my bar mitzvah. I probably was very good at it because I sang, and I had a big rabbi for like 6 months who taught me the Torah and everything. I don't think I enjoyed that. But what I enjoyed is getting the money and the ring and the watch.
Did in a very small synagogue that still exists. We sang it beautifully and everybody was very proud of me.
After that, my father never forced us to do what he's doing. My sister Elaine, she was exactly 4.5 years older than I am. And I was very... for me to paint and to draw was as easy as singing and dancing. And she loved what I was doing, and I don't know how she got the money, but she took me to an art school. It was called Arts et Métiers. You only went there for half a day, but you learn how to paint, how to do poster, and I adored it. And I owe that to my sister because at that time, when the Nazi invaded, when the German invaded France, you as Jew could not be in show business. You had to wear a yellow star. But she sent me to that school, which I adored. I was there for a year and a half.
When the German occupied France, I mean, that's where it drastically changed.
Came very frightening for everybody. They forced us to go to the police station to register it.
We have a big J stamp on our ID card.
Then we had to wear yellow star David in the front of our coat and the back of our coat.
This is early 1942. And that's where we started to wear
yellow star David.
And my sister Madeleine and me right outside our apartment house. And you can see on our left, you can see slightly of a star of David that we had to wear.
And we had curfews. There were rules. And you could not be seen on the street after 8 p.m. Otherwise, you would be arrested.
We cannot go to public schools. We cannot be seen in any public places. Parks, restaurants, hotels, movie houses, theaters. In the subways in Paris, we have to travel in one special compartment. Otherwise, we'd be arrested.
I remember the first roundup, they went to his apartment house. And they only arrested, in 1942, they only arrested Jews who were not French citizens. And they went to my apartment. They did not arrest my mother and father because, as I said, my sister Madeleine and I were French, so they did not arrest it. And my sister Ellen said, "Where's Ellen?" And she could have been quiet. And here I am. She was arrested. It was awful. It was frightening. Frightening. Even though I wasn't arrested, my parents were not arrested. But it was frightening. Ellen, who could have been a great actress, she wanted to be an actress. They arrested my sister, and unfortunately, my sister died in Auschwitz a few years later. Then the next time, they arrested everybody in an apartment house. Very few of them were hidden. Friends of us who were Polish and were arrested before, like 8 months before. They had a toilet, not in their apartment, but outside, and we had the key, and my mother said to my sister, "Madeleine, go upstairs and hide." Without any hesitation, she went there and hid. Then she said to me, go and join us. And I adored my mother, and I couldn't think of it. Why should I go with a sister? You know, what am I going to do in a toilet with her? And I refused to. I even went upstairs to give her some money and tell her what to do. And she, that's how she saved her life. They never, as a matter of fact, she told me what happened. When on that floor, which was the third floor, when the Nazis, when they went to all the policemen, they knocked on the door, got the people out, and they went to that toilet, and one of the guys said, "No, it's a toilet, let's go." And that's how she was saved. These are the two plaques in the front of the apartment house where I used to live when I was a child.
In memory of the 112 inhabitants of this house, including 40 young children, deported and dead in German camps in 1942. 118 people were deported from this apartment house. Only 6 came back, and none of the grown-ups made it. 2 young girls and 4 young boys.
The names of my family and my name is there at the bottom.
We were arrested on September 23rd, 1942. The chaos, the noise that came with the buses and a French policeman. And I must say that, unfortunately, most of the policemen were very happy to do their job. We were sent to Drancy. Drancy was a huge compound, a transit camp outside of Paris. There were no furniture. There was straw on the floor. Thousands of Jews waiting to be deported.
It's rare when people stay more than 2 days. We stayed there overnight. Didn't know what was happening.
At 3 o'clock in the morning, they woke us up with a list of people who will be deported that day. There were 1,004 people in the cattle train. Cattle cars were sealed. There were slots on each side. Small wooden buckets for toilet facilities for 100
people on top of each other.
And the crying and the moaning and the stench. And you cannot even sit.
Once you didn't have anything to eat, they gave you a piece of bread, that was it. We didn't know how long we were going to travel. You did not know that you're going to go to the gas chambers. We didn't know where we were going. We always thought, doing the train voyage, we thought, who knows, maybe we'll go to a camp or someplace. We did not know about gas chambers and nothing.
I was 16
years old when I was arrested. And I probably did not realize what was happening. In a way, I was lucky that I was that young and not responsible and not understanding completely what was happening.
My mother, the first day on the train, still hear some French-speaking language when the train stopped once in a while, asked me to write a letter to my brother Jacques, and I did. And I threw it through a slot, and he received that letter. I sent a letter. I said, "Dear Jacques, we are 100 people in this compartment. It is so terrible what's happening in them. I don't want to describe it, and I hope you will never see it as long as you live." I said, "We have courage. We hope to join some of the family, some of the sisters who were deported before us somewhere in France in a resettlement camp. We hope to come back and be a united family all over again. And just to prove to you that we did not know where we were going, I put a P.S. in that letter. I said, tell one of the sisters to go to the laundry and pick up the 10 sheets. Now, you know darn well if I knew that 3 days later, 698 of us will go directly to the gas chambers, I would never have written such nonsense. We traveled for 3 days and 2 nights. The third day, which was late, we arrived in a town called Kozel, which is in Upper Silesia. It's the border of Czechoslovakia and Poland.
And they asked the man, they opened the wagon train and said, "Man, sit down."
And they opened it, they unsealed the wagon, man, screaming, "Rasmus and Schnell, Schnell!" Even though I didn't know what Ras and Schnell means, soldiers in uniform. Somehow they said the men to jump off the train, and my brother-in-law jumped off. They must have called men from certain age. But my father did not jump off the train. My uncle did not jump off the train. My two nephews did not jump off the train. Men from 16 to 45, I have no idea. He jumped off the train. I followed him. The first time before I jumped off the train.
My mother said, "Be a good boy." And I'm 91. I get very emotional when I think about it. Her daughter And she said, be a good boy, do what I tell you. Don't be, you know, because she knew I was kind of bratty. The last thing she said to me, do what they tell you to do, be a good boy. And I guess I did.
I'm 16 and a half years old. I really look like 12. I don't look my age.
And then while I was sitting on the ground, there's an assessor who said, you, back on the train. Screaming. I don't know what he was saying, but he gestured me and pushed me there.
Hit me with his rifle butt. Now, what saved me is because we were very thirsty. We did not have anything to drink, no water for those 3 days. I stood at the open door with an older man. The assessor passed by. He looks at me and says, how old are you? Again, I don't understand. I'm seeing it in front of my eyes. Dogs on leashes are barking at us. Men being bitten by dogs and hidden by the SS guards. Men saying goodbye to their family on a train. It was just, the crying, the screaming was just, it's something that stays with you for the rest of your life. And the man next to me, the old man, said, I'm 16.
And there's another assessor who passed by and said, you, down! He saved my life. Because otherwise I would have gone with my family and the people sitting on train to the gas chambers. I didn't know about gas chambers. I didn't know where they went. Because I could not realize how bad it was. I really couldn't. And even when my mother said to me, I just jumped on the train, I did not cry like I'm doing now.
They kept 175 men underground. What happened when to Auschwitz?
Really, when you realize that we were not human beings. We were cattle, and that's the way they wind up.
15 men from my convoy came back alive. 15. When the train left, we were put into open trucks, and we traveled to go to the first camp. And we arrived in a camp called Atmut. It was a slave labor camp. It was a transit camp. There was only 150 people who could stay in to work in a shoe factory. I stayed in that first camp 19 months.
And I made 4,000 pair of wooden heels a day. And I didn't mind it. It was so noisy. In my machine, I was supposed to put a piece of leather or rubber on the heel. And I sang all day long because nobody could hear me.
I would sing all the French songs that I knew. That's how I kept myself alive.
Luckily for me, somehow the head of the camp liked me, and I sang, and I stayed there. There was a Polish guy who worked in the kitchen, and because I was singing, I got a nickname there. He wanted to say Didon, which means hey you, and he couldn't. He said Didi, Didi, and that became my nickname all through the camps. I was known as Didi. We all moved out because the English prisoner of war were going to take over that camp.
Atmut. We are all sent to a satellite of Auschwitz called Blechhammer. And there, it's a big camp. We are 3,000 in that camp.
It was run by the SS.
Brick walls, which we did not have in Atmut. Electrified barbed wire, which we did not have in Atmut. Guard towers, which we did not have in Atmut. Lots of barracks. SS guarding us, which we did not have in Atmut. They were all Wehrmacht people. Fleet change, and we arrived with 150 people in this huge camp. We were sent to the shower room and disinfected us. And then they gave us striped uniforms with shoes, canvas tops, and wooden clocks. Winter, they gave us a very light overcoat. We had a cap, and they told us to roll up our sleeve on our left arm, and they gave us the tattoo.
Suddenly, we had no names. We were not Robert Widerman, I was A5714 from then on. We were building a factory there, and it was hard work.
Factory was bombed every day by the Allied bombers because it was a factory that makes from coal synthetic fuel. Many of us did die from the bombs.
In Blechhammer, we saw the first hanging was, I could not believe it, because they make us stay on a roll call. And so it'll be a punishment to us. Don't do what he did. He stole a piece of bread. He goes, why, he's being hanged. And we had to wait for that. It was terrible. Fortunately, I just obey them. I didn't fight them. I didn't do anything that I shouldn't do.
We put a show on the last 6 months in the camp. We put on Sundays. I sang a song for the SS in Yiddish, which means I'm going home. I want to be with my Jewish people. That's what I was singing in Yiddish. Yiddish is very close to German. The SS understood what I was singing.
The reason for me to survive is I really never fully realized the situation. It's just automatically, you know, I entertained the people and it helped me to survive. And they didn't mind it. They liked it. It's very tough to, I think I did it automatically. I cannot say, hey, I'm going to sing because I'm going to save my life. I never thought of that. I never realized how, you know, how quickly they can kill me. By entertaining people, even though we worked hard, it saved my life. The entertainment. I was known as DD, the singer dancer.
January 1945, and we heard rumors the Allies are winning the war. The Russian soldiers are coming. Now they told us at one roll call, tomorrow we are evacuating the camps. January 21st, 1945, we 4,000 people in our camp. We start walking, and it's freezing cold. 4,000 people, SS on each side with guns. Their order was, you sit when you're not supposed to, you cannot walk anymore. You have to be killed. And they kept those orders, and we walking. We walk for 15 days and 15 nights. When we would find a barn big enough, we would sleep and would escape. I would go out of the barn when everybody was asleep, go to a farm and ask, please give me a piece of bread. And they would do that. They'd give me a glass of milk, a piece of bread.
And that made me survive. We arrived in Großwosen.
And Großwosen was a tremendous camp. We stayed 3 days at Großwosen. Third day, they found an open cattle train and they put us in it. And we on top of each other, striped uniforms, skeletons, most of us.
And we traveled for 3 days.
And the Allied bombers come down, the machine gunners. And the ones who could not go under the train fast enough, which I did, they were killed. We arrived in Buchenwald after walking those 6 miles late at night. Buchenwald, it was a tremendous camp. They had a big camp, but they had a little camp. When I arrived in 45, they were mostly underground fighters, communists, political people, Russian soldiers in their own compound. Ukrainians, homosexuals, gypsies, Jehovah's Witnesses, and the Jews were sent into the little camp. And then 3 weeks later, we were put into small barracks, 5 rows of bunks, no windows. You sleep like sardines on the side. You wake up with corpses all around you, and we shoved them on the ground, grabbed their clothes because it was very cold.
Fortunately, there were two French saintly people who saved my life, and a Czechoslovakian.
I met Yves Darrier and Claude Francis Boeuf. Political people, underground fighters. One was a musician, Yves Darrier, the other one was a scientist. And they saw this little frail body arrive in their barrack, and they took pity on me. They nurtured me back to life. They gave me food, and they saw to it that nothing's going to happen to me in Buchenwald. They knew a man, Hiri Zak. Hiri Zak was a Czechoslovakian, a communist.
Hiri Zak had a very important post in Buchenwald. And he was a bass player.
And Yves Darrier had an orchestra, a big orchestra. They had musicians who would play music while we were going out to go to work and when we came back from work, in tempo, march tempo. So we. And these musicians were lucky because they did not have to go to work. They would stay in the camps.
So they saved their lives this way, by being musicians.
And Yves knew I was singing, not from work, but I can sing a few songs. They had a big theater, and every second Sunday where we're not working, I would sing. That saved me. And Hiri Zak knew everything. What happened in Buchenwald, they started to evacuate the Jews again because they were too crowded, not enough room. They started to evacuate the Jews again, death marches, death camps. And he got my papers, put it aside, and he hid me in his barrack. Roll calls were endless. 2 hours roll calls be counted because there were too many people there. And we were talking. And I said to Eve, I said, you know, if
get liberated, I'm going to go back into show business. But Robert Widerman is not a good name for France. None at all. And we were talking about it. There was a movie done by a very big French actor director, so called Sacha Guitry. And he did a movie about Thierry Clary.
And Yves Dyer said to me, Robert Clary, that's your name, Robert Clary.
Yeah, that's a great name. And that's how I became Robert Clary in Buchenwald.
We had small Allied planes flying very low, and I remember being men on the ground making an SOS with their bodies.
And we knew that the Americans were very close by. And suddenly,
April 11th, 1945, nobody was at the roll call, no guards on the guard tower. Everybody fled, all the Nazis left. We were liberated by our own people. Late that day, the American army liberated the camp. And the GIs were just amazed. They have never seen such a thing. There were bones and ashes. And corpses all over the place. And when they went into the little camp where the Jews were there, the five was a bunk, and most of them were dying, and the stench was unbelievable. Grabbed us in their arms and they cried with us and kissed us. They didn't care if some of us had typhus.
Catch it.
Amazingly, today, April 12th, President Roosevelt died. I saw the American flag at low mass. That I remember because I said, who's President Roosevelt?
And I will never forget how my two French friends, Yves Dayen, little Francis Buff, and I walked out of the camp, all around the camp, liberated.
We gave a concert in the theater.
And Yves Dayen, we did a whole show for the Americans. And I sang in French, but in the song they know, By Me, Able to Shine, Joseph, but I sang it in French. Those are the part of my repertoire. And I guess they enjoyed it. So did I, by the way. When I was liberated, I was 19 years old, and hey, I'm going to go back to France and go back to show business. When my two French friends were ready to be repatriated to France, I went with them.
I was back in France, in Paris, May 4th, 1945.
We go to Paris, we are all sent to a hotel, and I really didn't think I would find anybody. And the first person I saw at the hotel is my sister, Nikki, Cécile, that was her job. She was in the underground, and then she was a soldier. And then her job was to take care of the people who came back from concentration camp. I arrived at our hotel, and the first word I heard, a scream of my name, Robert! There she was. I didn't think I would find anybody. And then she started to tell me, you have a brother who's alive, you have a half-brother, you have two half-sisters. I couldn't believe it. And I went right back to at the same house, Rue de Pont. I had a brother who was a tailor, and he was not deported, and he said, you should become a tailor like I do. I said, no, I'm going to be in show business. That's my life. 14 of us were deported, and I'm the only one who came back. And I didn't feel sorry for me. I said, okay. I'm going to go back into show business, forget about that. I don't want to talk about my... When people ask me, I said, I don't want to talk about it. Let me have a nice career. In France, I was a band singer. I did nightclubs, Shanghai. I used to do blackface. Because I remember Al Jolson, I remember Eddie Cantor, who did blackface, that was part of their big career. And I said, well, nobody does it in France. I rented a terrible outfit, kind of cute, funny. And I did blackface, and I worked in nightclubs. There was a big orchestra and a big dance hall. And they saw me, and they asked me to be the band singer. Huge dance hall in the, called Olympia. And I loved it. There was a girl, a very good singer, Yolande Cora, and I, we were the band singers. In 1947, there was a strike of musicians in America. And there's a man called Harry Bluestone, who wasn't show business, artist himself. He went to France to do some recordings because they were on strike here. And somebody told him, go to the Olympia, there's a girl who's a very good singer, you should record her. And he went there, and he listened to her, and he listened to me, and he said to his interpreter, he said, go and get me that kid. And he said to me, with the interpreter, because I did not speak English, I want to record you for America. I said, what? America? My whole life was the big stars of America. I loved it. It's the reason why Harry Bluestone liked me, because for a Frenchman, I sang with great rhythm like Americans. And he taught me the words of four songs. 6 months later, he calls me back. He said, you're a big hit in America, and I want you to come over. I was not married. All my sisters and brother were alive, were married. They did not need me. I didn't have a mother and father. What do I have to lose? I'm single. I have nothing to lose in France. France deported me. And I came here. October 1949, and I don't regret it. Very nice life here.
I arrived in the United States, October 1949. I was a big flop, I must say. It didn't work. I mean, I did some recordings and never made it, and they were ready to send me back to France. But I met my future wife, Natalie, through Merv Griffin. Merv was a very close friend of my wife, one of the daughters of Eddie Cantor. It was friendship, and the moment we set eyes on each other.
And for me, it was love at first sight, but I was too busy traveling. Where I was working, I think it was La Vie en Rose in New York. And somebody who was a stage manager for, they were doing a pilot of New Faces, and didn't know if it's going to work or not. And they said, we would like you to be in it. I said, oh, what? And I went there. And I remember Leonard Sillman, who was the producer of New Faces. He said, it may be a good part, it might not be a good part. You want it, it's yours. And a huge hit. I was 52. Everybody in New Faces was fantastic. They all did very good careers, too. Eartha Kitt, Alice Gosley, Ronnie Graham, Paul Lynn. It was wonderful. We were tremendous on Broadway, and we went on a tour for 1 year.
We did the first musical CinemaScope that came out and was a tremendous hit all over the world.
I was lucky after that. I mean, people wanted me, and I was in a plume de matin, a review by Robert Derry, and it was fantastic. Of Griffin. Was very important, right? Because he was very friendly with
Eddie Cantor.
I once went to the Palladium where they were working, and he knew who I was because he knew my recording, and he knew I was in the audience. He said, I'm a big fan of yours. And then he introduced me to Gene Plant, and we became close friends right away. And a great guy. And he had a fantastic career. Eddie Cantor.
Mendes star.
He helped me tremendously. He and his wife. He had a big show called Colgate Comedy Hour. When I was on the show, it wasn't just to sing one song. He really used me to do everything. Sing duets with him, dance, do blackface with him. I mean, it was fantastic. I love that family.
My wife and I were the closest friends.
Great, great friendship.
She was a great sense of humor. She was nice.
It took me 15 years to realize
in 65,
this is a woman I want to spend the rest of my life with.
She was married before. She had a son, Michael. And now I have 3 granddaughters and 5 great-grandchildren. I adore. And I'm glad she waited.
When I tell her, I think we should get married, she said, we've been together for 15 years. And let's make it legal. I said to her, well, let's get married. Let's go to Las Vegas. And then we lived, and it was fantastic. We had great fun. Great fun. And it was a great marriage.
Her daughter, she died in 1997. I was lucky in 65 when I did Hogan's Heroes. A tremendous hit all over the world. In my life, I did a lot of movies, a lot of nightclubs, a lot of Broadway shows. But people still remember me from the 6 years on Hogan's Heroes.
I didn't read for it. The producer, Ed Feldman, did a pilot of it. And somehow he wanted me. And he asked my agent, Al Gievsky was in my agent, the GAC. And he said, Ed Feldman wants to talk to you about a pilot he's doing, about a prisoner of war. And when I went to see him, he said, you don't have to read for me. They're exactly who I want. You want it? It's fine. I don't know if it's going to be a big part or a small part. You want to do the pilot? You're in. It was a great, great show with great people in it. Edward H. Feldman was a producer. Great guy. The producer who got wonderful writers, wonderful directors, and mostly the writers who knew exactly how to take care of this cast for what they can bring the best of it. I love working with everybody. Werner Klemperer, John Banner
were my closest friends.
And we were bams. Well, Werner was half Jewish. John Banner was Jewish. And he lost a lot of his family in Germany. He had a great wife from Belgium who was a fantastic cook. She was wonderful. Bob Crane, he was great. Richard Dawson and Larry Horvitz, Ivan Dixon was wonderful. It was a great group. Great, great group. People said, how can you do Hogan's Heroes after what you went through? I said, Hogan's Hero was not about concentration camps. It was prisoner of war. Quite different life. Quite different. I said, no, prisoner of war, they didn't have to go to work if they didn't want to. When the show died, I did a lot of nightclubs. And then somehow, my agent said, they want you for Days of Our Lives. I said, what is that? And said, it's a very big soap opera. And I love working. I said, okay, I'll try it. And I was frightened because you had to learn dialogue very fast, much more than learning for Hogan's Heroes. You have a lot of time. But I enjoyed it. And then from Days of My Life, did The Young and the Restless and The Bold and the Beautiful. And it was fun.
1980, I joined the Simon Wiesenthal Center when I realized that I cannot stay silent about my experiences. I saw a documentary in 1980 that changed my life completely. I was at home with my wife watching on PBS. It was called Kitty Returned to Auschwitz. It moved me profoundly. It was a story of a young Polish Jewish girl, Kitty Felix, 16 years old, my age, when she was sent with her mother to Auschwitz, survived 2 years of this infamy. She lost a brother and father. She said something during this documentary that really woke me up. I mean, it's like she said to me, it's for you, Robert. Listen to it very carefully. Do something about it. And I'm paraphrasing. She said, the reason I'm doing this documentary is because 30 or 40 years from now, and I'm talking about 1980, most of us survivors will be dead. And anybody can write anything they want about the Holocaust, making muck of it, just lying left and right. We won't be here to tell them they are liars. We went through it. We barely escaped.
Then there's a woman called Renee Firestone, who is also a survivor of the Holocaust. And she joined the Simon Wiesenthal Center to be a spokesperson. I went to see her talk, and I didn't want to do it, and then I realized it's something that I have to leave. before I die.
You owe it. You have to.
You have to. Went to the Simon Wiesenthal Center, use me. Because I was known at that time with Hogan's Heroes, use me. And they did that for 20 years. I went all over the United States, all over Canada, and talked about men's and humanity to men. It was tough at times because I really did a lot of talking. And I talked for an hour and a half, really. And I never felt like I was repeating a robot. I really got my brain and my heart into it when I was talking.
I never wanted to talk about my experiences. And the reason I never wanted to talk about my experiences is because once I became a free man, once I became a human being all over again, I wanted to live a so-called normal life and not rehash my past, not relive the 31 months I had spent in hell. It was bad enough that I had nightmares for a very long time. And they were always the same kind of nightmares. I'm going to be arrested all over again by the French policemen. But this time they're not going to catch me. I'm going to run away from them. And run I did, literally in bed, sweating, until my wife very gently will wake me up and say, Robert, you're running again. But as soon as I talked, nightmares disappeared. This is 1981. It's when I started to talk to high schools. And I went to a high school in Los Angeles. And after my talk, the students wanted to see my number on my arm. And you can see one girl is just in awe about it. She could not believe that people can be that inhuman. The world situation demands that survivors like me tell the truth. I'm absolutely outraged to see rampant anti-Semitism in the entire world. And I must tell you, it is the most gratifying thing I've done in my entire life. This is 1981, Jerusalem, the world gathering of the Jewish survivors of the Holocaust, and all these guys were in the same camp I was, Blechhammer. On the left, the bottom left, the three first guy are the Fogel brothers. The one above them, who was with a white shirt and the glasses, used to play the violin in Blechhammer. That's how he survived. Chachkas, we used to call him. The one next to him is a friend who used to live in my apartment house, Milo Adonair, and the others are friends who were in the same concentration camps. It was quite a reunion. This is Jerusalem, 1981. This is Lou Kadar with me, and Lou Kadar was one of our social workers when I was a young kid. Okay. Last time I saw it was 1938, 42 or 3 years later, there we are meeting each other again. She eventually became Golda Meir's private secretary and companion.
Those are the photographs that I took when I was traveling. And I looked at them, and then I said, okay, I'm going to paint that. I would stay home and paint every day, which I don't do now. I did 425 paintings, so that's not bad. They all Prismacolor painting, the crayon paintings, but I do use it like paint. When you look at my paintings, you don't say, what? It's crayon? Yes, it is. Prismacolor crayon paintings. As a matter of fact, they're still hanging on my wall.
Thank you.
loved the great composers and lyricists. And I was very lucky to have very, like Don Costa was a great conductor. But none of them became big, big hits. Not as like new faces. But I enjoyed it.
Honey, better hurry and let's meander. Ain't you going to the leader man, ragged meter man? Oh my honey, let me take you to Alexander's grandstand, brass band. Ain't you coming along? Come on in here, come on in here. Alexander's ragtime band. Come on in here, come on in here. Alexander's ragtime band.
From the Holocaust to Hogan's Heroes. My autobiography. I have a friend called Bob Bassing, and he helped me to put the whole thing. He didn't tell me how to write it, but he helped me to put the whole thing in a proper places. And I'm very proud of that book. I try to stay alive at my age. I have other friends. I watch television and
other movies.
I have great grandchildren, which I see. But I'm trying to tell people, try to understand why you're on this earth. Don't waste your time for something you don't like to do. And try to be nice to other people. That's really what I convey.
Mon oncle born in Paris had a childhood of splendor. Mon oncle didn't know a rainy day. He ran to buy some ice cream, even with his empty pockets. Mon oncle knew Paris when it was gay. But overnight his family grew concerned when yellow stars were everywhere you turned. Mon oncle lost his family and his childhood of splendor. Mon oncle saw 3 years of rainy days. And through the clouds of darkness, he would try to find some sunlight, hoping somewhere he would see some sweet bouquets. But flowers didn't bloom where he would pray, and all his prayers would end up in decay. Mon oncle came from Paris and arrived in California. Mon oncle took America by storm. The audiences loved him. He was blessed with recognition. Sing and to perform, and everyone was captured by his charm, but no one saw the numbers on his arm.